Hi, and welcome back to Football Made Simple. Jose Mourinho is one of the best managers of this generation, having led several top clubs to success at the highest levels. Mourinho is renowned for having a style of play focused on a tight defense and lethal counter-attacking brilliance. But how has he adapted these tactics throughout the years? Well, let's take a look. And if you want to keep up with your favorite teams and players, check out the One Football app. It will give you team and player stats, transfer news, and so much more. Absolutely free through the sponsored link in the description below. In this video, we'll focus on his tactics during his first stint with Chelsea, Inter Milan, and Real Madrid, arguably the most successful period of his managerial career. It's important to note that during each spell at each club, tactics changed between seasons. However, we'll focus on the general principles at each club and the similarities and differences between them. If you want a detailed look at each club, check out the videos linked at the end of this one. Let's start with the formations. At Real Madrid and Inter Milan, Mourinho had a clear alternate formation, which he used as a backup to adapt to particular matches. At Real Madrid, this was a 4-3-3, with an extra defensive midfielder helping to shore things up, so this was often used in knockout games against elite opposition. At Inter, his alternate formation was the 4-2-3-1, primarily to help out in wide regions, whether this was to exploit a weakness when attacking the opponent, or if the opponent was particularly dangerous down the flanks. Again, this was mainly used against elite opposition. This was in contrast to Chelsea, where Mourinho almost always opted for the 4-3-3. Mourinho's primary formation at Inter was the 4-4-2 diamond, whilst at Real, his first choice was the 4-2-3-1. Please note, all players were given the same numbering scheme to make it easier to see how players in the same position operated differently at the different teams. Let's start with the build-up play. The first thing to note is that all three teams were comfortable going long. At Chelsea, Cech wasn't comfortable on the ball, and in Didier Drogba, Mourinho had the ideal target man who could occupy both centre-backs, and when the ball was played into him, Lampard would often be just in behind him. At Inter Milan, Julio Cesar would naturally have two forwards in Milito and Eto'o to direct his longer kicks to, whilst Wesley Schneider was acting in support. At Real, this was slightly different, with Benzema being good in the air, but needing support at times, in the form of Ronaldo who would tuck in centrally alongside him when Casillas was planning on going long. At Chelsea, Drogba would look to knock the ball down into Lampard, who would be comfortable having a shot from distance. At the same time, if the flick-on was used, both Robin and Duff were comfortable tucking in and using their pace to run between the spaces onto the ball. At Inter, from the direct long ball, there would be less immediate support from wide regions. Instead, whilst one forward went up for the ball, the other tried to run in behind, or whilst Schneider and another midfielder tried to provide support for the knockdown. If it did come, they would then have the opportunity to create from these central areas. At Real, one of the modified front two went for the ball, whilst the other ran in behind. Crucially, often joined by Di Maria from the wide right, with Ozil providing support just in behind. But when they did start short, the centre-backs could also go along to Drogba at times. Ashley Cole was an attacking fullback and often moved higher up the pitch, as was Pereira, although less so. At Inter Milan, Lucio was decent on the ball and was often filtered into him. Zanetti in this formation wouldn't venture higher up on the build-up, however Maicon on the other hand would push up to provide width on the right-hand side. At Madrid, a major difference was dropping Xabi Alonso deep to split the centre-backs when they were under pressure, creating a spare man, and Alonso could then dictate from here. However, if he was picked up, Ramos was an outlet and was comfortable dribbling into midfield to open up new angles. Alternatively, when they used their default build-up shape, Arbeloa tended to remain deeper to help make simple passes into the midfield and down the line. The role of Marcelo was much more adventurous. Often he attempted more dangerous line-breaking passes into the forwards. At the same time, he often looked to dribble up the line if he was one-on-one with his man, which allowed Ronaldo to tuck in further. Or, if space opened up, he was comfortable hitting the long diagonal to Di Maria, who tended to maintain his width. Moving higher up the pitch, we get a look at the midfield function. At Chelsea, they primarily faced teams in a 4-4-2, so they had a natural 3-versus-2 advantage in the midfield, which they could manipulate in a few ways. If the opposition picked up Lampard and Essien, Makélélé would be free to receive the ball. Despite his reputation as defensive, with time on the ball he could pick out dangerous passes. But if one of the opposition moved to take time away from Makélélé, Lampard would push high into this space to receive the ball unmarked and look to cause danger higher up the pitch. And in matches where they needed to dominate the midfield, Lampard could drop deeper to assist here. The three midfielders had fairly defined roles. Makélélé the defensive screener, Essien the box-to-box dynamo, and Lampard the attacking midfielder. Inter often faced up against teams who used a diamond of their own, or more commonly a 4-3-3, giving them a man advantage in the midfield. Mata and Cambiaso were crucial to the build-up, rotating depending on who was free as they both had a great passing range. Stankovic, on the other hand, was more box-to-box, looking to give depth to the midfield and dip into the wide areas when necessary to create more width. Schneider was the center of the team though, moving to support the midfielder when needed, but often staying higher to orchestrate things here as most moves went through him. So, Inter had playmaking midfielders, a box-to-box midfielder, and the free attacking midfielder. Real Madrid's midfield did not have a dedicated defensive midfielder. Xabi Alonso was the ideal deep-lying playmaker, rotating the ball in deep regions but also using his passing range to find men in the wide regions and disorientate the opposition defenders. This was supported by the box-to-box midfielder in Sami Khedira, who was the more dynamic and when he received the ball would look to carry the team up the pitch rather than relying on passing. Ozil was the creative hub of the team, however, also given freedom to roam and often dropping deep to help with the possession when the pivots were under pressure, but also pushing high to thread the ball into the front three ahead of him. So, the Real Madrid midfield had a deep-lying playmaker, a box-to-box midfielder, and a free attacking midfielder. Now moving into the final third. Chelsea used a one-up, one-back philosophy with their fullbacks. Importantly, when the fullback did overlap, Makélélé or Essien would be ready to cover them in case of a turnover. Whilst higher up, Lampard could shift across to help them create an overload with the winger. The roles of the wingers could vary. Robin and Duff could tuck in narrow and look to cross to Drogba, who would push high whilst creating space for Lampard to receive the cutback. At the same time, they could look for shots from these inside slots. But this Chelsea side was renowned for constantly switching their wingers mid-game, and when they inverted, Robin particularly could cut in and shoot. At the same time, the far side winger ensured that the fullback always had plenty of numbers to hit on the cross. At Inter Milan, high up the pitch, they had to find ways to have width. Stankovic at times could move wide right, however, Maicon was a marauding fullback who pushed up at every opportunity, especially since Zanetti stayed deep. He was often their main creative outlet, attempting the most crosses for them, and he had two forwards with great movement to aim for in the centre. On the left, Zanetti tended to stay back. Eto'o played on the left of the front two, so he was selfless and could pull out wide when required to provide balance. But Mourinho sometimes played Sully Montari at left central midfield, and with the spare midfield numbers they had, he could push wide and look to cross on his left foot. However, the main creative route was by getting the ball to Wesley Schneider in the centre between the lines. When the centre-backs looked to close him down, the movement of the forwards meant that the threaded ball was a consistent option. But if they sat back, his strikes from range were lethal. High up at Madrid, Marcelo fully moved up the flanks, giving Ronaldo the space to tuck into the centre where he would often have shots from range. But if the opposition were drawn to him, it would grow the space for Ozil to receive the ball and move higher up to create. But if the centre was crowded, Marcelo could be an outlet, looking for Benzema and Ronaldo in the centre. But Di Maria tended to hug the touchline more, comfortable drifting here and crossing. But much like Ronaldo, he could also tuck in and have a shot. When defending, all his teams could sit deep in the different shapes. The wingers tracked back at Chelsea, and there was less pressing in general. They were comfortable holding position, and in general, the defenders were comfortable holding their position until an error. They stayed narrow, looking to force the opposition wide, as the keeper and centre-backs were dominant in the air. Similarly, Inter and Real often defended the centre of the pitch due to aerially dominant centre-backs who could deal with crosses. Although at Real Madrid, it was Di Maria who tended to tuck in to then allow Ronaldo to stay higher. When transitioning, Chelsea tended to go more direct, looking to hit Drogba, who could hold it up while support arrived to subsequently play it into the wingers, either directly or through Lampard. At Inter, when launching the counter-attack, Cambiaso was the key, as once found, he had pinpoint long balls to the wide regions. Eto'o often pulled wide, where he could then use his pace to lead the counter-attacking charge. With Madrid, they would look to work the ball to Ozil first, who used his movement to stray from the defensive midfielder. Once found, he would lead the charge, joined by Ronaldo, Di Maria and Benzema, leading to several goals. But I would love to know down in the comments what you make of early Mourinho's evolution, and which team was his best. A special shout out to everyone who's been able to support Football Made Simple on Patreon so far. If you want to help the channel, I'd love it if you considered supporting on patreon.com/footballmadesimple, and you'll get perks like early access to videos, exclusive content, and so much more. For detailed looks at each team, check out the videos linked at the end of this one. But that's all for today, and remember, keep it simple.